Many of you must have installed TestNG, but still I'll first tell you how to install TestNG. Okay, TestNG is a basic framework which helps us to make test cases, right? Which helps us to make a platform on which we can validate data, fail the test cases, pass the test cases, right? Present some reports and all. Okay, so the first thing is installing TestNG, right? To install TestNG, you need to go to Google and type TestNG Eclipse in the Google search. Fine. And what will happen is you'll have the first link. I require everyone to open your emails. So no, not your emails, your Eclipse, I'm sorry. Right. And you go to this link, install the plugin. I'll give you the link. Fine, hold on. This is the link. Right. Take this link. Right, take this link. Fine. So this is the link to install plugin TestNG as a plugin inside Eclipse. Right. Need to go to help, install new software. Okay, and a window will open up. Inside this window, paste the URL, hit the enter button, and you will have TestNG. Okay, click next, 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 and keep on installing it. Just install it now. Right, so I hope you have installed it. Now you can go to Window, Show View, Other, and under Other, if you look under Java, you will have TestNG. So that means TestNG has been successfully successfully installed. Fine. So now once I've installed it, you can make the test case. So what I'll do is that I'll make a new Java project over here, and I'll call that project TestNG_tutorial. Okay. So in TestNG, the first thing is that, like for example, in log source folder, I make a new class known as login test. Okay. Fine. In TestNG, the first thing is there is no main function. Please take care of this point that there is no main function. All right. Like for example, what you have got inside TestNG is that you have got @test_annotations, for example, public void do login. So this @test is known as an annotation. Fine. This @test is known as an annotation, and it signifies that this function do login function is a test case. Okay. But obvious that you will get an error. Okay, but obvious you will get an error, and what you need to do is that you will have to move your mouse on the error, and you will see the option of adding the TestNG library. Okay, you can add TestNG as a library, then move your mouse over the error again and import the test annotation. Okay, that's it. Right. Now this test case is blank. Even if I run this file, I'll just click on the run button and it will run as a TestNG test. So you will get the output like this, that total test runs are 1, failures are 0, skips are 0. So this is the test case which actually got executed. Fine. Along with it, you also get this tab, results of running the login test. Okay. This particular tab in Eclipse, fine. So it will say that the do login test is passed. The green sign indicates that it's a pass. Fine. Okay. So now what you can do is, hold on. Inside the test annotation, you can write your Like you can actually write the Selenium code over here. Okay, for example, if I write executing login test, and when I run this, it runs fine and it also prints over here executing login test. There is no main function inside testng. Okay, now you can also fail the test case. Okay, to fail a test case we use assertions. Okay, you can, there is a class known as assert. Assert class, this is the inbuilt class inside testng. This class helps us to do the validations. Okay, it actually helps us to determine between the right and the wrong. Okay, to help you report something. For example, if I write assert dot, I will get lot of functions. I will use assert dot assert fail. Right, assert class will automatically be imported. And point to be noted is, please note that you are importing org.testng.assert. At times people, they tend to import org.junit.assert. Okay, so I will write over here assert.assert fail, and I will write some error message. Okay, so when I run this code, you have this message, test runs are 1, failures are 1. Okay, and yes, this is a Java file. Yes, Narinder, this is a Java file. Okay, please install testng if you have not installed. Okay, so this is a Java file, and this denotes a failure. And if you scroll to the top, okay, you will have some error message displayed over here. This is some error message, and in the results also it will fail, and some error message wordings will come up. Sometimes you want to compare two values and pass or fail your test case. Okay, in that case also you can use assertion. You can use assert dot assert assert dot assert, hold on, assert equals, right, you can use assert dot assert equals. You can give the actual and the expected value. The actual value will come up from the application, right? The expected value, you can take it from a properties file, or you can take it from a text file. Okay, so when I run this, this will actually run fine. So expected value are given equal to actual value. Actual value will come from application, and expected value can come from a Excel file, properties file, text file, wherever you want to store. For example, you want to check the title of a page. You can give the actual and the expected title. Now if I give a wrong title and if I run this, it fails. It fails with some error message. Assertion expect error, expected something, but we found something else. Okay, right, so this assert equals can be used to compare two things. Fine, so I hope you are getting my point. Fine, now you can also use assertion in this way that just a minute, you can write over here assert dot assert true some condition. Okay, a condition can be 3 > 2 and some error message. Any error message. Now what is this kind of an assertion? Okay, this condition, it should evaluate to true or false. Okay, right, if it evaluates to false, then the assertion will fail, and whatever is the error message over here, that particular error message will be thrown. In this case, this condition will evaluate to true. We are asserting true, so this test will not fail. If I run this, it will pass. Failures are 0. But if I write 3 > 12, then this test case will fail, and this is the error message which will come up. This test will fail because this condition will evaluate to false. So when I run this, this test case fails, and you know, any error message comes up. Over here, and over here also you'll have any error message. So for example, we had discussed the function, right? Is element present? Remember when we were working, I can check the presence of that element with that function. So you can put that function over here, is element present, and if it is not present, you can throw the error message. Okay, right, fine. So you got my point, right? You have to write the test, and there are three types of assertions. One is directly you can fail, other is you can compare and fail, and the third is you can fail through a condition, right? Okay, now do one exercise. Okay, try to write a Selenium code. Fine, try to write a Selenium code which will, hold on, yeah, which will take you to this website, salesforce.com. Okay, go to this, I'll write it in detail. Go to this website. Secondly, check presence of login button. Okay, thirdly, click on login button. Right, you need to go to Salesforce, check whether the, now write a test case which will check the presence of the login button, then click on it if it is present. Fine, go to the next page. Okay, check the title of the next page. Right, enter wrong username password combination, put any username password, and check the presence of error message. Okay, so you need to go to Salesforce, click on the login button, enter any username password. Okay, you have to compare the title of this page as well. Okay, click on the login button, and then you will get the error message. You need to check whether the error message is present or not. Fine, so you need to use three assertions over here. The one is check the presence of the login button. Second is check the title of the login page. Okay, and after entering a wrong username password, you need to check the presence of the error message. So you need to have three assertions. Okay, so I am assuming you have installed TestNG. Okay, now please write a program which does that. I'll give you 10 minutes or so. So let me give you the solution. Okay, you have this website with you, and you have this, you can say, this is the code, where, like this is the test case. Fine, so what I'll do is that I will hold on, I will comment this part. Okay, I will comment this part. Please guys, please keep yourself on mute. Fine, so what I'll do is that I'll write the code. Look, if you are not able to write this much code, okay, then you are lagging back in the course. That's what the thing is. Most of you were not able to do it. If you are not able to do this simple piece of code, then later on you will face troubles in the course, because when I start with the frameworks, okay, it will not be very simple. All right, so two or three people pinged me the solution, the rest of them were not able to do it, so please be careful. Okay, you can go to the website http://salesforce.com. Okay, after going to salesforce.com, you need to click on the login button. So using Firebug, let me write the flow first, and later on I'll put the validations. Okay, this is the XPath for the login button. Okay, right, so we will take this XPath, right? And we'll write over here driver dot find element by the XPath this dot click. Fine. So you click on this and obviously enter the, hold on. Okay, enter the username. Okay, this is the username field. Okay, driver dot find element by the XPath of the username field dot send keys, some username and some password. Okay, so you can take the password from the password field. Okay, and then you can also simulate hitting the enter button of the keyboard. Okay, so this will actually help, like this will actually like it will try to log you in. Fine. So now the next step. Okay, the next step is you need to put the validations. Okay, so to put the validations, obviously the first thing which I told you was check whether this button is present on the page or not. Okay, look, if you are not able to hear, not sure, is everybody able to hear me? Okay. Right. Now, Narendra, one thing, you were asking me about your Firebug, it's not working. You need to uncheck the option over here that generate the absolute XPath. Uncheck the option. Okay, fine. So you need to do that. Alright. Now, out here, once you log in, right, oh, sorry, once you go here, you need to check the presence of this element. Okay, so how will you check it? Okay, you can write over here driver dot find elements, find all the elements on the page by this XPath. Okay, it will return you, this will return you a list, you get the size of the list. Okay, and you can put an assertion that assert dot assert, hold on, assert true. Okay, assert dot assert true, make sure you are importing assert class from testng. Okay, right, and assert dot assert true, the condition should be s equal equals to or s greater than 0, and if s is not greater than 0, then the error message should be that login button not found. So I'm getting all the elements on the page, okay, with this particular XPath. If there is no element, then s will be 0, s will not be greater than 0, this condition will fail and you will get an error. Okay, are you understanding my point? Right? Fine, so assert dot assert true, what it does, I told you earlier, right? So it checks for some condition. Okay, and if that condition evaluates to false, it throws the error message. So if s is not equal to 0 or if s is not greater than 0, it will throw this error message. Now you will click on the login button. On the next page, you need to have the titles compared. Okay, the title of this page, fine, the title of this page, okay, let me get it from Firebug. on this page under the head tag, the title, this is the title. Okay, fine. Look, we'll try to find all the elements with that XPath. If the size becomes 0, then obviously it will not be there. Okay, the list, I'm trying to extract all the elements. Right. Okay. So now you can write, this is my expected title. I've got it from the page source. Actual title will be driver.getTitle. This will give you the actual title. You have to compare expected and actual titles, right? The expected values will be keeping in the Excel file or properties file. Okay, we will not be keeping them like this. Okay, right, yeah, whatever you want to use, if you want to check partially, you can also do that. Okay, so what you can do is that you can write over here assert equals. Fine, you can pass over the actual and the expected title over here. If both of them don't match, then you will have some error generated. Okay, now after entering username and password, you need to check whether some error message is coming up or not. Fine, the error message over here has this XPath, it's a division with ID error. Okay, so what we'll do, the same thing. Okay, we'll find all the elements on this page with the XPath of the error message. If the size is greater than 0, that means, or in this case, if the size is greater than 0, and if it is not greater than 0, you can say that no something like this for wrong username, password or something. If total number of elements on the page with error message are not greater than 0, that means you don't get any error message. The condition will evaluate to false and then you can throw some error. Okay, so this is what I wanted you to do. So when you run this, okay, one thing dot window dot maximize and driver dot manage dot timeouts dot implicit wait for 5 seconds. Right. Okay. Any questions? Okay. Yes, we can compare the size. Yes. Because if the size is actually not greater than 0, if it's 0, then that means there are no elements on the page with that XPath, right? So when I run this, okay, hold on, it opens the site. See that it clicks on the login button, it goes to the next page, enters the username password and then gets the error message. And if you look at the output, there is no failure. That means all the three conditions they passed. Okay. Right. Okay. Right.
Ashish, instead of find elements, you can use find element also, right?
It will directly throw an error, that element not found. If you use driver.findElement and if the element is not there, what happens?
Okay. Yeah.
You get an error, right?
Yeah, got it.
That the element is not found. But in this case, it will get a list. But the size of that list will become 0.
That's true. Correct.
Okay. Yes, Deepak, you can write all the conditions. Okay. Now, if suppose I give the X path of this button wrong. Okay. This button is not present. Right. And if I run this code, then this test will fail. Okay. Yeah, obviously find element is for a single element, right? So you go here and now it will fail after 5 seconds. You see a failure coming up because this wait is for 5 seconds, right? So it will fail after 5 seconds. You see that failure is one, and you will see the error message that login button not found and the code did not proceed ahead. Now this is with assertion. If an assertion fails, the test case stops on that particular line. Okay, so it will not move ahead, it will fail the test and it will stop. Alright, fine. Now at times you would want to skip the test case. You don't want to execute it. Suppose you are executing 100 test cases, out of 100 you want to execute 50 and you don't want to execute 50. Okay. So in that case, what we do is that we take a flag. Right now I am equating the flag to yes. Okay. So we can check that if flag is equal to yes, then throw new skip exception, skipping the test as run mode is no. So skip exception, what it does, you have to import it, org.testng skip exception. It will skip the test case. If I run this test case now, it will not run. Failure 0 but skips are 1. The test will be in yellow color. Okay. Right. But generally we keep this flag outside the test case. We don't just keep it inside the test case. It can be kept outside the test case in some file or something. We'll talk about that, but just understand that skip exception, if you throw it deliberately, it can simply skip the test case. Okay.
I have one question. So instead of finding the element, say a login button, if I find the element with the X path, the login, and it get its text, and it say that if I put an assert that if text matches login equal to what I'm getting from the X path, so it should also work, right?
Yes. Yes. You get the text from the X path, driver.findElement.getText. When you use find element, you can find it by any particular locator, whether XPath or anything. You got my point? Right? So, now, moving ahead. At times you would want, define, this is the login test, very simple. Okay. You would want to run this simple login test multiple times with different sets of data. Okay, right, that is you want to run this login test with 5-6 different sets of login IDs and passwords, and probably you need to read those login IDs and passwords from an Excel file. Okay. So how do you do that? Okay, so let me take up an example. For example, I'll make a new class known as RegisterTest. Okay, you are registering a user on the website. Okay, you make a @test annotation, say public void do register. So this test case, what it will do, it will register a user on the website. Fine. Now, after registering a user, you need to suppose run this test case 5-6 times with different sets of data. And with each data, you need to do different kinds of validations. Okay. So for that, you can use something known as data provider annotation in TestNG. Okay. Right. You import this. Data provider annotation will provide the data to this test. You have to link this data provider to this test case. Okay, so please listen to this carefully. There are standard steps which you need to follow. Okay, the first step is that you need to tell this test case that your data provider is getData. Okay. Find that this function will return your data array. Now we use a two-dimensional object array in this data provider. What we do is that we have a two-dimensional object array with certain number of rows and certain number of columns. Okay, the number of rows are equal to number of times you want to run the test case. Okay, if I want to run the test case 5 times, then the number of rows will be 5. Okay, if you want to run the test case 6 times, then the number of rows will be 6. Right? Okay, and the number of columns in the test would be equal to the number of parameters you have in the test case. Say username, password, email ID, phone number. These are the parameters in the test case, right? So number of columns are equal to number of parameters and number of rows are equal to number of times you want to run this test case. Okay, right. So this is a grid structure. This is 00. I hope you know this. This is 01. This will be 2, 3. Okay, so every cell has every cell is identified by this indexing. Okay, so you create this object array known as data over here. Okay, with certain number of rows and columns, say 3 rows and 4 columns. So in our case, we are creating a data array with 3 rows. Okay. And 4 columns. Right. Fine. So out here, that means I want to run the test case 3 times, right? And every time I run, there will be 4 parameters. So I'll fill up this array. I'll write over here data array 0 just a minute. Yeah, data array 00 equals to say your name, say username 1, 01, 02, 03, then password, then email, say x@gmail.com, and then probably your phone number. Okay, so this is the first set of data with which you want to run, and then the second set and then the third set. Okay, so this can be u2, p2, and say y@gmail.com, some other name, u3, p3, and z@gmail.com with some other. Okay, right. So you can write over here return data. So the first step is creating the data provider. Second step is linking the data provider with the test case. The third step is putting the data inside the two-dimensional object array. And the fourth and the last and the most important step is number of input parameters in the test case should be equal to number of columns. Since there are four columns, I will have four input parameters: string username, password, email, and phone number. That's it. TestNG will come to this test. It will understand that the data provider is this function. It will go to this function. It will understand that there are three rows, four columns. So I have to run the test case three times. Every time I run, I have to pass over four parameters. Okay, it will check if the function takes in four parameters. If it does not take four parameters, you will get an error. The number of input parameters should be equal to number of columns. Okay, and now when you run it, you will see that total test runs are three. This test got executed three times with three different sets of usernames and passwords. Okay, and that's how you can run. Later on we will see how you can read this data from the Excel file as well. Okay, so basically we read this from XML or Excel file and we actually put it from there out here. But right now the first step is reading the data from here, right? Okay, fine. Now anybody with any questions? Anybody regarding this with any question, like free, feel free. If you're not able to understand, you can tell me. Right? Fine. Now why have we used a object array over here? What do you mean by object? Look, object is the super class of all the classes in Java. I can store integer, I have stored strings inside it. I can also store integers. If I want, I can store numbers inside it. Okay, rather than string, I'll have to write integer out here. So when I run this, it will run fine. So you can pass, you can store strings, you can store boolean value, you can store anything inside an object array. That's why if I make a string array, then it's mandatory for me to store strings inside it. Alright, so you have to be a little careful. Okay, you have to be little careful. Yes, object can accommodate any data type. Okay, boolean, string, decimal, that means float. Okay, you can put any type of data, but practically we only put a string. Even if we have to give a number, we put it in a string, because you know what, when you read the data from the Excel file, whether it is a number or anything, the data will always be read as a string. And when you enter the data in the application, okay, if you have a phone number field and you have to enter a phone number inside it, you will use send keys, and send keys accept strings. Are you getting my point? When you write driver.findElement.sendKeys, you have to pass over a string. So mostly I personally have never seen an integer data or something. Even if we have an integer, we treat it as a string and use it. Okay, right, fine. Now moving ahead. Okay,
Ashish, one more thing. if you want to read through the Excel, right? So where you can write the code before data provider, before test?
Out here.
Oh, okay. Here.
Okay, we will write the code out here to read the data from some external source.
Okay.
It can be any source.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
not just Excel file. Yeah. Okay. Now, moving ahead. Right. So this was about parameterizing. This was about making a test case. Okay. Now, what if you have multiple test cases? For example, I make a new class known as, say male underscore scenario. This is a scenario in which I can have multiple test cases, say @test public void login. Okay, inside it I'll write logging in the app, import it. Then in one single file I can have multiple test cases. This can be check mail. Okay, this can be say logout. And inside it I'll write logging out. So you can have three test cases. Yes, that's possible. You can have three test cases inside a single test. Okay, so inside a single Java file, when I run this, it will execute three. But if you look at the output, checking mail, logging in and logging out. So the order is not the same. Don't expect that if you have written three test cases from top to bottom, they will be executed in that order. No, that's not going to happen. Okay, if you have to prioritize your test cases, that's fine. I have to run this one first, then this one, and then this one. Okay, then you can put up priorities in your test. Like, for example, yeah, you can check that, Narinder. Yes, you can write over here priority equals to 1. Priority equals to 2, priority equals to 3. So you have prioritized your test cases. This is the highest priority, then the second, and then the third. And when you run this, now it will execute in the order in which you actually wanted it to execute. Okay, logging in the application, checking the mail, and logging out. Fine. Now, what if the login test case itself fails? Okay, for example, I write over here assert dot, I deliberately fail it, fail because of some reason, any reason. Okay, right. So are you getting my point? I hope you are getting my point, right? So when I run this, they'll execute in the order, but execution is okay. What is the glitch over here? Can anybody tell me the glitch? That's why I was silent. Yes, dependency. Okay, the point over here is dependency. Login test, if you are not even able to log in, how can you check the mail or log out? The other two test cases should never be executed. Okay, if you are executed this one, okay, login test, and if it is failing or even if it is skipping, then the other two tests should not be done. So what you'll have to do, you'll have to inject dependency, and that's done using the tab depends on methods, and you can give the name of the method out here. The method name is login. And similarly over here as well, depends on method login. Now if the login test is failing, if I run this, the other two will be skipped. You see that the other two test cases have been skipped. The first test is failing. Okay, right. And you can make logout dependent on both of them if you want. You can put a comma and put the name of the tests over here. Okay, so you can prioritize your test cases. You can make your test cases dependent on each other. Okay, especially when we are using Selenium Grid. Especially when you are using Selenium Grid. Okay, we use a lot of these things over there. Right, you will come to know. Okay, as I proceed with the course, you will come to know about a lot of things. Right.